Welcome to YouTube Developers Live. We have special guest Vidyard here today, all the way from Waterloo, Canada. We actually have Cody and Tyler. Say hi, guys.
Hey, I'm Tyler. Cody.
And they were nice enough to join us. So if you haven't heard of Vidyard, it's actually a video player for marketers. And rather than talk through it too much, I thought we'd just dive into the history, and then we'll go right into a demo. So why don't you guys tell us a little bit about the history of Vidyard, how it kind of came about, and the product itself, and then we'll go into a nice demo.
Sure. So Vidyard actually started out as a company that was producing minute-long explainer-type videos for companies. And we would give these videos to our clients, and then they'd ask us, so what do we do with the video now that we have it? And so from that, we kind of grew into making a platform of the answer for what to do with the video. And so that means giving them the tools to analyze how well their video is doing, how much people are watching it, as well as integrate it into all sorts of other platforms and share the video analytics with them.
Okay, great. That's kind of funny. So you're making the video marketing stuff first, and then they were like, oh, well, what do we do with it? And then so you built a player tool for them.
Yeah, exactly.
Awesome. Great. Well, let's jump into the demo, because I had a couple questions, because I know some people aren't quite sure what that means to have a video player for marketers, but it's pretty clear once you see the demo. So why don't we jump into that?
Sure. So I'll just take over the screen. So yeah, so here's just the main dashboard of our platform with a very simple analytics view here of different things for your account wide. So if I hop inside of a specific player here, in here you'll have all sorts of tools for creating stuff like a call to action at the end of your video. So it's got just a simple builder where you can set up a form so that you can capture people's emails.
Yeah, and this is, I saw this on your demo. It was a pretty nice feature. Basically, it's like comes out the side and asks for information. It's not like too intrusive. It was kind of a nice feature. I could see how marketers would really love that.
Yeah, exactly. So we're all about kind of giving marketers these sorts of tools to do what they need to do. As well as from that, there's an A/B split testing area for your splash screens. And here you can see the one that we have set up on our homepage right now, which is using these three thumbnails. And then we then give the analytics for each of those three thumbnails. And you can see that the one is at almost 10% click-through rate. Meanwhile, the other two are more on 7.5. So right now we have kind of a clear winner of which one's the best out of those three.
Yeah, this is a really neat feature I liked in your product. So, thumbnail really does impact, click-through rate. So like they said, what they did is they basically take a bunch, let you set up a bunch, and you even let them set up the percentage for where when it shows up, right? Like 10% here, 20% on this one, so then you can get an idea of the click-through rate, right?
Oh yeah, you can fully distribute it however you want. So if you have one that you think won't be that well, but you want to try it anyway, you can give it a very small percent so that it doesn't influence the overall traffic all that much, but you can still test how well it does.
Yeah, and you guys were talking a little bit about general best practices. So I know from what you're saying, it really kind of is different depending on the scenario, but at least for a general side, you were saying something about there's a difference between if it's not front and center and if it's off to the side. Would you mind kind of telling the audience a little bit about that?
For sure. So if you have a kind of smaller player off to the side of a page, then it makes much more sense to have a thumbnail that's brighter and stands out more, because that way people will actually notice it off to the side and then click it and watch it. Versus if it's something big and center in the page already, then you want something more engaging and personable so that they're more curious as to what that could be, and that would lead them to actually watching it.
Yeah, and you guys were a little surprised with this one, right? The guy on the beach ended up doing the best. Did you think one of the other ones would be a winner instead, or?
Yeah, I think we thought the one with the girl and the sandcastle and the dog would be better, because that's kind of more things going on. But I guess people like the guy on the beach, so.
Yeah, so the important thing is like general practice, as we went over. But yeah, if you're going to test it, like even ones that you don't think will win may end up doing really well. Great.
Yeah,
well,
it depends entirely on your audience and what they like or don't like, and that's the point of A/B split testing, is to figure that out.
Great. Well, you guys had, like, you do a lot of analytics as well to help these marketers out, right?
Yeah, so we have a whole page dedicated to that, called Analytics Center, which gives a very easy to way to view all your general views, devices and browsers, where your videos are being embedded, geography, as well as all of these graphs can then be further limited by the actual player, so we can get that homepage and kind of narrow it down from there. Yeah, so it's all about just giving marketers all the information and all the statistics they need to make the decisions they need to make.
Great, and one thing I like about you guys is you really, you want marketers to get the most bang for their bucks. You allow them to export to YouTube, and then you pull all the analytics from there, so they can have their own customized player on their own page, but then they push that content out to YouTube to get more views.
Yeah, exactly, because YouTube is such an invaluable source of people. So we are always going to fully support pushing your video to YouTube. So the general flow for that is like upload to Vidyard, so then we can do all sorts of our more advanced analytics, but then push that video to your YouTube channels and market it through there as well. And then here in the Analytics Center, you can see how well it's doing and compare it to how it's doing on your homepage.
Great. Well, let's dive into the, thanks for giving us that little taste of the product. And obviously you can see a more detailed demo of things on their site, Vidyard.com. Why don't we talk a little bit about the technical section? So I want you to talk for the developers out there. How did you implement this, and what programming language did you use, and why?
Ruby, but as a Sinatra application instead. We have a mix. This stuff that interacts with YouTube is both working in Ruby and also working in Sinatra through the Google API client, Gem. And we're running data through the V3 data API as well as the.
Okay, great. You cut off there for a second. I think you said you were using Ruby?
Yeah, it's on, we're Ruby with some Rails as well as a Sinatra application as well. Interface with the Google stuff through the Google API client. Yeah.
Great, and it sounds like you guys are already using the new version, version 3 of the data API.
Correct, yes, we are.
Oh, great. Yep, thumbs up.
Yeah, we made the switch about 4 months ago, and we were using another Ruby gem that did most of the Google stuff or the YouTube stuff for us, but. We just decided to write our own stuff that does more specifically the type of thinking to do with YouTube, and it's gone really well thus far. Yeah,
especially the analytics, because V3 is much better at being able to break down by geography and stuff like that.
Yeah. Our new analytics API is pretty helpful rather than the large zip file. So was there anything that came that surprised you a little bit when you were integrating with the YouTube APIs?
The only thing that we've been a little bit surprised by is the way the tokens work, and sometimes getting tokens that expire. But beyond that, it's all been the guides are really helpful, and it's worked out really well for us.
Great. Well, any features you'd like to see in the product in the near future?
The only thing that we've had a lot of clients ask for, and we haven't been able to do, is uploading and choosing custom thumbnails on YouTube through the API. Now, I know that's available to content providers, but we can't do it for just general users, and that's something we get asked for all the time.
Okay, yeah, we do go ahead. Yeah, we do have the video thing. We're opening that up more. So keep an eye on that. But as you said, we do have one right now, but it's a little bit limited for access. Well, great. Well, any other thing you'd tell a developer that's getting started with the APIs?
No, I think like just looking through that YouTube API doc site is really good. And there's some good code examples on there. And yeah, it seems to work really well.
Definitely Stack Overflow is a very good resource, and you guys are very active on it. So any questions you have, just go to Stack Overflow and ask.
Yeah, definitely. We do have a keyword, YouTube-API. So yeah, my team actually monitors that. So make sure you check it out. Well, great. Well, I think that wraps up our show. As always, we're always looking to hire. If you're interested in developer relations, check out developers.google.com/jobs. We have some openings. So check it out. And a big thanks to Vidyard for coming all the way, well, I guess virtually all the way from Waterloo and jumping on a hangout with us. Again, check out Vidyard.com and their new video, the one with the guy on the beach. I actually watched it. It's pretty funny. So check it out. And thanks again, guys, for joining us. And we'll see you next week.
Thanks for having us.
Thanks.